inspiration for the book is the Kohinoor diamond around which the entire novel is plotted and set. And I guess I've always wanted to write about the Kohinoor diamond for a very long time. Just simply because the way it was taken away from India, the annexation of the Punjab, these are major historical events in India's timeline. It all happens pre-colonial, so I mean it's, you know, the Punjab is annexed in 1848 and India doesn't become a British colony until 1858. But it is one of the reasons why the Sepoy Rebellion happened, because of the dissatisfaction from Lord Dalhousie going around summarily annexing kingdoms. And then taking away the Kohinoor diamond. And, you know, the diamond itself has a sort of special place in every Indian's heart, I think, because we think of it as being India's. The novel itself is framed between 1817 and about 1854, approximately. But of course, the diamond has existed well before that. It goes back to some 2,000 years. So there's a legend behind that. So it's a long... it has a long history. The thing I always say is that because there are no new stories, there are no new plot lines, there's no story that nobody's ever heard before, no matter what it is. So what I'm doing in my books is telling India's history, but I'm retelling it. And then for the Taj Trilogy, it was Mughal history as we all know it and as we probably learned in high school. And in history class. But it's told from the point of view of unusual protagonists, the women of the empire. And yes, they are factually, historically accurate. What I've done is said, here are all the players, here's what happened, and that's all true. And then what they thought about it, how they reacted, what it must have meant to them, all that comes from my imagination.
Okay.
I've been thinking about the book for a long while, but I didn't seriously start reading until about 3 years ago, just to see whether there was a story or not. To me, yes, the point when it left India was actually the most important part. And that happens about three quarters of the way into the novel. So you set up before and then you deal with the consequences of after. I wanted to tell it from the point of view of the women of the Sanaa.
Right.
And yes, for the Taj Trilogy, it was very difficult to find actual facts, because the women were so cloistered that, you know, into certain... There's poetry that's still extant today and that people will attribute to Noor Jahan. Is it true? Who knows? The male authors have had their names emblazoned in the front of their works for centuries, so there's no doubt about the fact that they authored those works. So maybe it's just part of the myth of Noor Jahan that they say the poetry is attributed to her, the jewelry making is attributed to her, the fashion is attributed to her. Even with Noor Jahan, there's actually a lot that the British travelers to the Mughal courts talked about. Even though they never saw her, they kind of realized that she was the power behind the veil. So they took a lot of trouble to talk about this one particular wife of Emperor Jahangir. If I needed to know something about her life before she married Jahangir, when she was essentially a non-entity, then I would go looking to see what her father was doing or what her first husband was doing. And her father was pretty senior in the government, but her first husband was just a Persian soldier, and yet his life is documented. I mean, you know, even the commonest man, so to speak. I have this scene in The 20th Wife where she travels to Lahore because Khurram and Arjumanda betrothed to each other in Lahore. And I know that she's in Bengal with her husband. At least fictionally, I had a reason to move her from one place to the other and for them to meet again, for Jahangir and her to meet again during that betrothal, because Khurram is Jahangir's son. So he would have been there at that time and he would have had access to the Zanana. He would have been there and they could have seen each other. I'm sure the older women in the Zanana taught them some stuff. I mean, it was a city of women. I think the eunuchs themselves, obviously, were extremely powerful because they were the one part of the Zanana that could freely move between the Zanana and the outside. Then if you cultivated the good graces of the eunuchs, then you got to know stuff. As far as the rest, they were fairly well educated. They had access to math tutors and Persian tutors and music and poetry. And I mean, anything that they wanted to do, they could do. The tutors came into the Zanana to teach them. There are stories of how the male tutors would sit on a scaffolding and then they'd be hauled up parallel to the window and then they would teach and then they would be hauled back down. You know, the thing with the short stories is I tend to write contemporary short stories right. about issues that bother me. It's trouble to write them and I'm usually upset about something when I write it. I couldn't sustain a novel for sure on that topic dead by the end of it, because, and I'm sure the reader would be also by the end of it, because novels do need, as I say it in the afterword, you need a lull. And the way I write short stories is I gallop, you know, you begin galloping and then you end galloping and then after that it's all reflection comes once you're done reading the story and then you have to think about what happened. I'd say the first 100 pages are very difficult for any piece of work, any long novel. Mm-hmm. And I'm usually struggling because I don't understand the character, I don't know where they're going. I know where I have an idea what the entire book is supposed to be, where I want to take it. And then at the end of it, by maybe 150 pages or so, I hit my stride. And then I start, then I gallop towards the end. And I'm writing all the time at that point. And then I go back and revise. By then I'm very comfortable with my voice, with the way the novel sounds. It's very difficult to find representation. It still is very difficult. You need a good literary agent. After 5 years, I sent the 20th wife out for 5 years, that many rejection letters. But I think I was also revising it along the way, so I'm sure it read a lot better than it did the first time around.
Okay.
I always joke about this, but my early rejection letters were those photocopied, dear authors, you know, we don't want your book, basically. And then it started like, dear Miss Sundaresan, they were actually writing between my name. And then they were still saying, we don't want your book. And then I remember before I was represented by my current agent, the last letter was a dear Indu letter. It was like, dear Indu, but we don't want your book. You know? A lot of people who are reading, especially the Taj Trilogy, and I'm hoping they'll read this book. And also there's going to be a TV series now on the Taj. So they've almost done filming, I think, and they're going to can it and edit it and then maybe release it along with the launch of a new channel called Epic. I was confident that they would do a good job. It's too early, but I don't talk about it.